What's up, everyone? Welcome to the finale of Let's Play Dark Souls 2, Crown of the Ivory King. We are once more back on the other side of the broken bridge, and this time it's going to be to rescue that final missing Loyce Knight. He rests at the top of this snow-covered hill up here. It's pretty difficult to see the pathway up here. I know I certainly missed it the first time I was on this side of the bridge. But you climb the hill through a series of these ramps up here. Got a couple hedgehogs to deal with. That failed spectacularly. I'll deal with you. That's not too bad. Just running into them doesn't do that much damage. But when they clip you like that, rolling at you, yeah, that hurts. Oh, he fell off. That's cool. I don't think he'll be able to path his way back up the ramp. Holy shit, what a view this is. Oh my god, that's beautiful. Yo, stop attacking me so I can appreciate this. Oh man, I'm getting distracted looking at the city below. God damn, that looks so cool. That's one of my favorite vistas in the game so far. And there have been a lot. Oh, he did find his way back up the hill. Oh well, one swing is all it took. Wow, I did not handle that exceptionally well, but yeah, this really reminds me of the city from Attack on Titan. Okay. There should be something on this. Oh, just Vine Bomb. They had a lot of new really... Whoa, Knight. Really... I don't want to quite call them pointless, but... Not... the most functional consumable items just by... virtue of being consumables in the DLCs. God damn, what a gorgeous, gorgeous view. Oh, that's the best. Okay, yeah. And you can even see the inner wall portion of it. You can see the wall that divides the inner wall from the outer part of the city. Oh, god damn it, that's amazing. Boulder. I don't want to head down there yet because it doesn't look like I'll be able to get back up here easily without going all the way back around, so I'll save that. I'll check that out after I rescue the final knight here. So after we rescue this knight, we will head on to the final boss, and I was reading some interesting stats that from, sent IGN's way. So it looks like four of the hardest fights in the game, statistically, are all bosses from the DLC. Sin, Alana, Sir Alan, and the Fume Knight, who wins like 93% of encounters. And that's not including any bosses, Ava, the Ava Twins, or the final boss of the Ivory King DLC. Oh, I forgot about the boulder. Let me backtrack up there. I'm willing to bet the final boss of this DLC winds up ranking up there, because boy are people willing to bang their heads against that fight endlessly with no preparation. People seem really reluctant to backtrack and find those knights. I was doing this on another character. I was putting my sign down and doing co-op. I got summoned by the same guy 5 times in a row, and he didn't do any backtracking to get the knights. He died 5 times in a row. Oh my god, is that going to create a big... Oh, that's so cool! The little boulder snowballs down the hill and grows... Oh my god, is that going to connect the broken bridge? Oh my god, that's totally what that does! That's the coolest shortcut ever! That is the coolest shortcut I've ever seen! Is that what it did? It did! Oh my god, that's so cool. I didn't do this on my other character. That is amazing! Okay, so now both sides of the broken bridge, well, the whole bridge now, is connected by this big, snowball. Oh, that's cool. Wow. Okay, let's get on with the final boss fight. I'm gonna do some quick preparation and head over there. Alright. We have rescued all 3 Eleum Loyce knights. There's another one in front of the boss gate that you just get for free. You don't have to rescue him. He's standing posted there on his own. Whoops. Lana does not have anything new to say just yet, we will get some new dialogue out of her once the fight is complete. Oh, man, and they're all ready to plunge into the chaos to join you to fight this epic final fight. God, this is cool. This whole section starting right now is incredible. The old chaos plunging into it with all of the uncorrupted, unmolested Knights of Eleum Loyce, and immediately it's a war. It's a battlefield down here. So it's uncorrupted Loyce Knights versus a whole army of burnt Loyce Knights who plunge themselves into the chaos to fight back the demons and who eventually succumb to it. Oh man, everything down here is so cool, from the drop to the surroundings to the fact that this is clearly what I've been saying all along. They built this place on top of Lost Izalith. Oh god, the fight, the way this fight works, I can't get the words out. It's pretty cool. So the knights aren't just there to make this a really epic battle scene. These knights that we've been rescuing, they help us fight off all the burnt Loyce Knights. But they also, aside from evening out the numbers game, all the burnt knights are constantly spawning out of these portals. They're mostly infinite spawns. There is, if you kill enough of them, they do, like most enemies, stop respawning. A Loyce Knight, the white ones, can sacrifice themselves to freeze the portals that the burnt knights keep spawning out of. They stop you from being overwhelmed by infinite adds during the main boss fight, which we haven't quite gotten to yet. If you get all four of the Loyce Knights, you get an extra one left over to help you fight the boss once all the portals are frozen. The boss himself is kind of lame. We'll see him in a second. We have two portals frozen. There's only one left. We still have a whole lot of the burnt knights to clean up, though. I haven't really been on cleanup duty too much. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4. Looks like 3 melee ones and a pyro. The pyro's the most dangerous. The pyro's also the sturdiest, and they tend to block a lot. The three melee enemies don't seem to block that often. Weirdly enough, the pyro is most dangerous in melee range. She has a really, really strong, fire whip? That if you stay in it for just 2 or 3 seconds, it'll kill you. Okay, these are both really weak. Yeah, it's just four of them. And I got one buddy left. And they do, the Loyce Knights do die fairly easily. They aren't that much of a help against the boss. Their main purpose is just the mechanical gimmick of freezing the enemy generators. That Loyce Soul is a very important item. It's something that we're gonna have to grind for later on. Like, I love the fight down here. Like, the actual pre-boss stuff, the presentation, all of it's super cool. There's also that, is that Fire Snake? I never recognize the names of any of the pyromancies. I can't match them to the actual spells. Okay, it's just you. Figured the, it is just the last knight joining me because I got all four. So that leaves me one left over. Oh, yeah. Oh, man. It's a shame that the boss himself is a low-rent, lame Gwyn, because everything leading up to the, like, actually fighting him is the coolest shit ever. Oh, man. God, that portal reminds me of, something out of Warcraft. Okay, so the first king from these Lost Crown DLCs that we've actually seen is the final boss of this DLC. And my Loyce Knight, my good friend, didn't last too long. Oop. The Burnt Ivory King is the final boss. And he's not too much of a threat. Whoa! Unless I do things like that, like roll into his attacks. Man, I kind of wish Alon was the final boss. He's a much cooler version of this. So we've seen basically all of his moves for this phase of the fight. He does activate a second phase soonish. Might be doing that right now. So he's gonna jump back, buff his weapon. This is where he becomes even more of a Gwyn clone, with that crazy range. This is new though. Crystals kind of reminds me of Seath. He doesn't have the exact moveset, it's just, I guess, what he most closely reminds me of. Okay. At this point, he does hurt quite a bit, and there is one little trick to be aware of, and it's attacks that you would... The timing of rolling through some of his attacks changes quite a bit, because that should have impaled me. Because of the increased range on his attack from that lightsaber, attacks that used to only hit in front of him now also hit behind him. I'll try to point out when it happens. It's mostly the jumping attack that hits behind that. So if you roll too early there, you can afford to roll early in the first phase of the fight. If you roll too early once he buffs his weapon, he hits behind him now. So you can roll behind him and still get hit. But the jumping stab, not a big problem. The fight itself is disappointing. The build-up to it's excellent, though. Screw my timing up a bit still. And the buff does eventually run out. Kind of like Throne Watcher and Throne Defender. Yeah, I guess he is more of a... He's either a low-rent Gwyn or a high-rent Throne Watcher. But that's gonna be it for the Burnt Ivory King. And we get his soul, and at the foot of the portal from whence he came, we will pick up the final crown in the Lost Crown trilogy of DLCs for Dark Souls 2. Let's just get a nice, cool view of this. A faint heat lingers in the ancient crown. Yeah, I appreciate being down here one more time. So, let's check that description out. It's not going to say anything too revelatory, but tradition. Crown of the Ivory King who once ruled this land. Far to the north, a king built a great cathedral to appease the raging flame. But when he sensed the degradation of his soul, he left without a word, leaving everything to Alsana, who had unbeknownst found a place at his side. But these were events of long ago, and today, no one even remembers the king's name. At least this time, though, we have a body to put to the king. At least this time, we've actually encountered him. So we've got one Loyce soul from this fight. Soul of the Knights of Loyce. The Knights of Loyce were taken by chaos and lost all sense of purpose and being. The few woeful souls that trudged back home were guided by some faint vestige of self. The soul is pure sorrow, and only Alsana can put it to rest. Is there anything else I want to take a look at? I don't think so. Oh, the soul. The proud Ivory King was ever merciful and devoted himself to the protection of his great land until he was devoured by the flames of chaos. The wondrous soul of this great king can be used to acquire numerous souls. Okay, we've seen all that. Okay. I really like the lore behind the Burnt Ivory King, too. He fought and fought and fought to protect his kingdom. Alsana froze the land over to protect the outside world stop to keep the flames of chaos and the demons it bore at bay. The knight led the charge against them. It's all really, really cool stuff until he eventually succumbed to it, died over and over fighting, exhausted himself and his knights, was consumed by the flames of chaos, and he eventually hollowed out and lost all sense of self down there.
You've granted my one wish. Now, I have no regrets. I was born amidst the dark. Long ago, in the depths of the abyss, my father perished. The dark shattered into tiny pieces, one of which was me. How frightened I was. A frail thing, born from but a splinter of dark. I felt that I might simply disappear. I am, in fact, the incarnation of my father's fears. I saw that the king of this land was strong. I sought him only to sustain myself, to smother my fears. Now, I realize that he may have known all along. I was born of fear, and my lord provided comfort. And so, here I remain, heiress to my lord's wishes, watching over chaos. Until the end of time. The knights of Eleum Loyce were swallowed by the chaos. Where their souls still remain. I pray for their deliverance. The knights of Eleum, where their souls.
My favorite takeaway from that is that the king knew what she was all along and took her in and accepted her anyway. It's lovely and kind of remarkably sweet for a Souls game. Anyway, we're not quite done yet. It's time to grind out 50 Loyce souls, which only dropped from the burnt knights in the old chaos, so see you in a while. Okay, this grind sucks. It is fucking awful. It is really terrible. Getting 50 souls is nearly as bad as the pure Bladestone grind from Demon Souls. I got so bored grinding that I went and farmed materials to upgrade the Cestus and the Bone Fist just to show the Bone Fist moveset off. But I'm pretty close now. Should get it this run. I'm at about 48 or 49, I lost count. A good way to get them is to put your summon sign down and then jump into the pit. You get 3 spawning at a time once you kill the boss, but no knights to help you out. And it's like 1 or 2 minutes between the spawns down there, and they aren't infinite. You can exhaust them once you kill enough. So you put your sign down while you're grinding down there alone, and then you eventually get summoned in to help people out with the boss, and the souls actually drop for you in co-op. And what's more, I think they drop a little bit more frequently when you're co-oping. It's still a shitty, shitty, shitty grind. And I hate how this is the penultimate thing you do in the DLC, because aside from this, and a kind of lukewarm final boss with amazing presentation, mind you, the DLC is stellar, and it kind of sours me on it a whole bunch. Just this stupid, awful grind. But hey, at least the Bonefist moveset is the most radical shit ever. And I fully upgraded like 12 weapons beforehand before I started the DLC, so I've been constantly switching to keep myself entertained. Check this shit out! Oh, the uppercut! This is the power stance moveset. Or at least when you power stance Bone Fist with another fist weapon. There's a unique power stance moveset for two of them together. Oh, not too good. Wait a minute. Oh, yeah, that's the last one. Even though the host died. Oh, yeah. Oh, woof. Thanks for dying, host, to make my life easy. But seriously, though. Fuck that grind. But eternal love for the Bone Fist. Praise the sun, harder than I've ever praised it. So happy to be done that. Kneel before RNGesus. Prostrate yourself before the god of random drops. Let's take a look at this really cool Bone Fist moveset. So, the backstep, R1 is a flying kick. There's another combo that is a sweep into the flying kick. There's a couple of different uppercuts. The rolling attack is a shoryuken. There's all this crazy cool shit. Oh my god, this is the best moveset ever. This awesome sweep. The craziest stun lock potential on these things ever, and the L2 when you power stance two of them together is a Hadouken fireball and all. It's the best. Let's talk to Alsana though. Let's get this done with. I sense a night's joyous elation.
Kind visitor, please accept my gratitude. Joyous elation. Kind visitor, please accept my gratitude. I sense joyous elation. Kind visitor. I sense a night's joyous close by. Yes, very close. The only being born of dark. You will face hardship like no other. Take this. My sisters are as a thick dark, their lust for souls insatiable. May you find the will to resist their desires. Go on, kind visitor. May you reach your journey's end one day. Go on. May you reach your...
I feel like the only cool part about the Loyce soul grind is because you give them to her... Oh, and you can see even down into the pit, but you can't quite see where it transitions into the old chaos. Nice little trickery there. A little bit of visual trickery to hide. Probably what's a loading screen. That's why you can't pan the camera up while you're dropping. Because you give the souls to her in tears, she slowly reveals more of the path. She breaks away more of the ice. The ice is literally breaking, to get a little more on the nose. And I think it's a way of you proving yourself to be an ally to her, so eventually she trusts you more. So as you give her more and more corrupted Loyce Knight souls, she trusts you more and more until you can finally talk face to face with her. Okay, now that I've given the souls to her and gotten my rewards for it, I'm gonna head down to the crypt for the final time to talk with Vendrick and see what lies at the end of this trilogy of DLCs. See you in a sec. For the last time, we are back here in the crypt where we once fought Vendrick and where we can now again enter the memory of the king. And we're gonna see what all of this has been leading up to. We're gonna see what our reward for gathering all four crowns, Vendrick's included, was. But first, we have to do it in proper, fashionable attire. been really digging the looks of the Mad Warrior's mask and the rest of Veldstadt stuff. And of course, we'll throw on some pretty weaponry. Artorias' sword. Gotta be fashionable when you address the king.
One day, fire will fade, and Darth will become a curse. Men will be free from death, left to wander eternally. Dark will again be ours, and in our true shape, we can bury the false legends of yore.
Only, is this our only choice?
Seeker of fire, coveter of the throne. Seek strength. The rest will follow.
The ashen mist fades. I think that is the last thing you can say to Vendrick. So any of the crowns from here on out will prevent you from being cursed. Now says heat radiates from the ancient crowns, not just a faint heat lingers. What makes a king? Okay, they don't have a new description, and if we go up to the body, we can no longer enter the memory of the king. That is the ending of the DLC. Remember what our mission coming to Drang Lake in the first place was, though. We came here to cure your own curse. You come here to cure your own curse is how I should word that. Mission accomplished, right? Right? Our reason for this journey wasn't to save the world, it was to save ourselves. It's not perfect cure, but it's immunity from the curse from now on, and immunity from hollowing, more importantly. The fact that it says it radiates a faint heat, or now it says radiates heat, much stronger, makes me think of the first flame. The fact that there are four fragments of Manus coveting the flame of the great souls, as the Herald told us. Four ineffable souls were originally taken from the first flame. The crowns have to be directly connected to the first flame. I'll talk more about that in just a second. I'm trying to put my thoughts together on what Vendrick told us about the burying the false legends of yore. Okay. If we already... Oh god, I can't remember if we read this already. Pretty sure I took a look at this. The soul is pure sorrow, only Alsana can put it to rest. I'm kind of surprised that the description doesn't change, or that we even still have them. Soul of Alsana, Oracle of Eleum Loyce, who prays in silent vigilance, this child of dark in reverence of the apocalypse, devotes herself to a ritual in hope of appeasing the raging flame. The soul of this augur of fear. So she was the sum total of Manus's fears. The wondrous soul of this great king. We have read that. So we're going to trade in some souls to artifacts, and we're going to see what some of these new weapons do. One of them is really cool, the ivory straight sword. Is that what I want? Oh, right, and there's also the stuff you get from Lud and Zalan and Ava. That stuff is all right. It's really... it doesn't strike me as being anything particularly special. We'll check it all out, though. Just in the hopes of being thorough. Oh, and there's the Loyce shield that you get for trading that soul in. And Eleum Loyce, the weapon itself from the soul of Alsana and the Ivory King's Ultra Great Sword. Those last two are pretty interesting. So let's check Eleum Loyce and the Ivory Great Sword out. Ivory Straight Sword, that's one of the ones from the pets. Sword of Fabian, Knight of Eleum Loyce. This blade crafted with ivory ore native to the land, harnesses souls to slash foes. Okay, that is actually kind of interesting. Sir Fabian led the loyal knights of Eleum Loyce straight into the depths of chaos to exterminate the terrible things that dwelled there, but not one of the selfless knights returned. Factually untrue. Unless they mean the knights who went with Fabian didn't return, which, maybe. Maybe that's who the king was, Fabian. Great Sword of the Knights of Loyce. The Knights of Loyce were commanded to strike down each malformed terror that arose from chaos, and they would not hesitate, even if it were their own king. I wish you actually fought some proper demons down in the old chaos. You saw what they were going down there to stop from letting loose in the world. There it is, Ultra Great Sword of the Ivory King of Eleum Loyce, wield with both hands to realize its full strength. It is said that the Ivory King was once the highest-ranking knight in his home of Ferosa, famed for its god of war. After taking his crown, they say he was the first to swing his sword. His sword in times of need. Yeah, and that is what you do. What you can do when two-handing it with, actually, that's both attacks, not just the strong attack. You also have to meet the 30 strength, 30 dex requirement in order to get the lightsaber effect. Shield of the Knights of Loyce. The Knights of Loyce were commanded to strike down each malformed terror that arose. We saw that. Eleum Loyce, curved sword forged from the soul of Alsana, formed by two curious blades, got farming on the mind. The sword can restore an ally's HP with a hit from its strong attack. The enigmatic Alsana quietly found a place at the Ivory King's side, and when his strength was fully drained, he conferred this sword, inscribed with the name of the land, to her. That's how deep the trust between the two of them ran, despite her being a fragment of the dark. And as the description said, the strong attack from this weapon, the regular moveset's not too special, the strong attack, though, can heal yourself at the cost of a lot of durability, or it can be used to heal allies who you hit with it. That's all you get from Mornifex, though. I thought, while I've been talking, I think I have a working theory for what Vendrick told us. So, in our true shape, we can bury the false legends of yore, is what he said. That really seems like it confirms something that I've been saying for a while now. In Dark Souls, the true shape of the player, of all humanoids, or all humans right now, their true form is that of a hollow. And it wasn't until the pygmy came along and fractured the Dark Soul that we actually became human. Hollows turned human by little shards of the dark. And the curse as it relates to the dark is our desire and ambition and the loss of that and our memories and our need to fight it. That's what the curse is. In other words, the curse of life is the curse of want. And the only real cure for the curse is to rid the world of humanity, which is just the dark given shape, and go back to being hollow. The dark has to disappear, and we have to let the flame fade and let the world go back to gray before the first flame. Really, really cool ending. It might seem a little anticlimactic at first, but I'm pretty happy with it. Anyway, that's, I'm gonna use some of these, 1.3 million souls. That's it for the Lost Crown DLC trilogy. From hasn't ruled out future DLC just yet. And with how good the DLCs have been, I would be all for more DLCs like this. As long as the proper care and time and attention is given, especially to really important stuff like the level design, I wouldn't be opposed to more DLCs if they just told self-contained little side stories. Stuff like what you got in Shulva between Yorg, Sin, and the King down there. I suspect they'll probably do more stuff, like more events like they did with the chest. More in line with what they would do with the occasional world tendency events from Demon Souls, but with nothing else really announced on the horizon, that's going to do it for the Crown of the Ivory King, and until further notice, Dark Souls 2. It's been a great journey, Now it's time to take it to New Game Plus. Thanks for watching, everyone. Take it easy. Have a good one.